not going to start just yet. We had some people trickle in late yesterday, too. So in about 10 minutes or so, we'll get started. Everyone signed in, right? All right,
yeah. Perfect. Everybody can shut their ringers off on their phones, too.
Yeah, try to turn your ringers down, because we had a few interruptions yesterday, too.
Got a question, Phil.
Yes.
On our Fed's website, they have two different reverb touchpanels.
Yes, because the XD cabinet has it.
But they have, that's just.
Yep.
We have
the
blade.
That's the blade, yep.
You were right, Tom.
There's three different button panels, actually. There's a Bluebird.
I'm sorry for that.
So the Bluebird will not fit in an XD, and an XD won't fit the Bluebird. But you can take parts off of it and switch it with the new style and put it in an old cabinet.
Okay.
And then the blade has a totally different.
Yep. It's a white instead of kind of a yellowish one.
Yeah.
It's kind of smaller and it's not even compatible. You're not even close.
Since you can't really see a difference on here, I'm like, I don't know.
The components themselves are compatible,
the
but the
well,
containers.
So there's old ones that are opto-based, and there's some that are switch-based.
Right.
So some things are interchangeable depending on how far back. Some were non-liquid resistant. Some were liquid resistant.
See, that's what I thought the difference was.
Yes.
We had in the beginning, we had the liquid and the non-liquid.
Yep.
And then with the XD cabinet, it's a different color, satin and nickel.
USB kicks out a different way.
Right, right. So, and it's longer, so.
Make sure you sign in.
There you go.
And Leanne, just so you know, the Bluebirds are end of life,
and
so parts are getting harder and harder and harder.
Like my Valley CPUs?
They are shipping.
Checks in the mail, too.
They had 70.
Taxes will be low.
They had 75, and we took 50 of them because they wouldn't give us 75.
Took what you could get.
Yeah, we took all we could get. But it sounds like the 2.4 is that close to being.
We're waiting because the OS has to be approved to accommodate the new BIOS chip. BIOS chip, technically, I think it's approved. The computer's approved, but we can't send the computer out
without
it working.
You won't have any software.
Right.
Because the software.
Excel actually has a whole bunch of waves, I think, sitting there waiting with the wrong computers in them. And they're sitting there idle.
And there's no computers to put it on.
Yeah.
We don't even have computers to put it on.
Yeah.
You know what? We'll take out the stuff and put it in right in a minute.
Oh, yeah.
It is what it is. What we're doing.
Good. How are you?
Anybody else coming from Gold Rush? You guys had like six people on the list today.
There's Jerry. I don't know about anyone else.
I probably recommend
that. Didn't see the flyer.
Gas station and a restaurant, they
didn't see the hotel. Well, this area does not allow you to put
high
signs out, so. Mm-hmm. Which is fine by me because I only live for my own.
Okay. Any of you guys hear anything about yesterday's seminar from coworkers?
Nope.
Good.
You're lucky he has a good sense of humor. He was.
I'm serious. He's a Scottish.
There we go.
Are you not prepared, Tom?
Why do you come back on stage and do all?
Follow.
What do you call that? They're all clapping right in.
Yeah.
Like, where's the Yonkers?
Where's Dan at?
I so wish it was.
Make sure you sign in.
I heard lunch was good yesterday. It was.
That's what a lot of people was like, oh, lunch was amazing.
I saw him in the text yesterday, and he was like, yeah, man, it's good yesterday.
Not that much. Should have stayed for lunch. And we had lunch late at 12:30, so I ran lunch from 12:30 to 1:30. By the way, everyone, we have lunch, which will be the middle of the class, around 4 o'clock.
That's not lunch.
It's
closer to supper.
It's supper, dinner, linner, whatever you want to call it. But it'll be a deli-style spread back there with all kinds of lunch meats, a salad, soup. It was really, really delicious yesterday, so if you have some hunger, around 4 o'clock, we'll have some food. We'll call it that. Yeah,
right. It's just lunch, so I didn't eat
right.
Breakfast.
Oh. We will be breaking about once every hour or two to give people a chance to go to the restrooms, catch up on muted phone calls that you might have missed. But again, it'll be a very quick 10 to 15 minute break each time so you can accomplish those tasks. Mostly, you know, trips to the restroom and stuff. So we're getting close. We'll give it another minute or two. It's 12:09. 12:10, and then we'll get started. Since that game is starting off, we'll be waiting for Dan anyways.
Everybody, that technician has a voltmeter. If you don't have a voltmeter, Walmart has a voltmeter and a wall
outlet tester
for $15, $20.
Yeah, I think it's under $20 at Walmart. You go to the little hardware section they have at most Walmarts. It's a combo pack.
You don't need $1,000 meter, but
yeah.
And it helps.
It's a small little multimeter that'll do just that. It'll test your batteries, it'll test AC, and it'll also do a continuity test. Does anyone need to know what a continuity test is? Is there continuity? It means a continuous loop where you've got a connection between this point and this point. And so a continuity test will make a tone if you have a continuous connection all the way.
So basically, this ringing tells you that
continuous, like I said, where they will go over points where you need continuity.
You think you have a broken wire,
all the way to the ground.
You put it on one end of the wire, and you find the other end of the wire, and you check to make sure that wire is not broken in between. These doors open and close, open and close.
They're constantly open and closing.
They bend right here.
And they spin right here.
You can't really test a USB cable type tester. They do have testers for that. They plug into these meters for every type of cable ever made. But basically, you know, wires get pinched down here, they get slammed in doors, they get put under the base. If this bezel's not working, number one thing is everything plugged in? Number two is, does it have power going to it? Number three is the wire good? So the continuity would just tell you from one end of the wire to the other. The main thing I do on that is I go all the way to the one board and I go all the way to the other end and check. If I don't have continuity, I come to the next connector. I just do the whole wire and then I start finding where the connector is broken. That's continuity. And then power is, in Illinois, one of the biggest problems in Illinois is fast power. AC coming from the transformer outside into the building and
make sure you sign in.
And then to the wall.
Ali, sign in on the sheet too.
So there's a continuity tester that Phil was talking about that you plug into the wall outlet and tell you if the hot neutral ground are in the right
configuration, the hot is ground.
If the switch hot neutral.
There's all kinds of issues that have the power in the walls.
Switch hot and neutral on one of your wires and not on the other one, and you touch those two cabinets or they touch together, you become the power and you're gonna get 60 volts through you. I've seen more than one thing. We have problems. First thing I go up, check the power, there's the problem. Call your electrician. I just drove for 4 hours, it's something you should know.
Just recently I had a TO fix calibration issues with all their machines. He had an electrician come out. We were about to drive out there and start fixing stuff for him. It's like, he took my advice, I said, check your outlets, and if they're wrong, have the electrician fix them. When he had an electrician come out, they were wired incorrectly, and they were all missing ground, and so he was having a lot of touchscreen issues. And again, we'll go over that during class, because grounding is paramount, not only for the function of the machine, but for the lives of your customers. Because the ground wire is there as a ground fault. It's sort of electricity has a place to go as an option. So you don't get somebody electrocuted on the machine. So it is paramount that the ground wire is there and working the way it's intended.
Another tester that everyone should have, this is a cheap $50 tester. They sell $10 testers, but a Cat 6, Cat 5 cable tester. Some of the biggest comm problems that we have out there is folks make their own wires. Maybe they didn't crimp it down right or whatever. It gets trapped underneath the cabinet.
The
vacuum cleaner runs it over. Who knows what happens out there? But if you're having comm issues, the only way to test for sure between the gain and scientific gains equipment is with the cable test.
Yep.
And this one does much more than that, but it's a simple, it sends a power down each wire and the other side lights up.
Home Depot has
two of them light up at the same time, throw the cable away, and put a new one on the plate.
Yep.
Or if you're missing one, throw the cable away.
When you buy a Cat 5 analyzer, they come with a little printout that tells you the proper way to wire connectors. And so if you've done it before, you know the color code layout and how it goes. But some people are new to this, and they're just like, well, the boss bought 1,000 feet of Cat 5 cable, and now I've got to do these things. You got to know it's not just all the colors in order. They actually intermix in the middle. So that'll tell you if there's a mismatch or if there's wires in the wrong position. All right, so we're going to get started. Again, if there's people that ask questions, and you're, again, this happened yesterday, a lot of faint-voiced people. I might hand you a mic so that the rest of the people in the room can hear your question. Because if they hear the answer without the question, they're kind of confused. So try to enunciate, try to speak loudly, and if, again, if you need to, I can hand you another microphone. We have two. And, again, there'll be a lot of different Q&As after each section. All right? So we're going to start with Dan Lucerna from Scientific Games, and he's going to go over a lot of stuff.
Yeah, not that much.
He's my <It's> all important. Oh, wait. While Dan's talking, guys, the eagerly anticipated USB bets and pins I'm going to distribute. I had one on every single placemat yesterday. People were a little obsessive about it. And they started stealing all the extra pins. So I'm going to give every attendee here one of these pins. Now, this is a regular nice ballpoint pin, but it's also a USB drive preloaded with not only the latest G2S guides for TwinStar, WMS, and Valley products, but there's some cabinet information, some air code information. There's a lot of stuff in here. You'll see it once you plug it into a computer. So I'm gonna pass these out while Dan's going. Everyone will get one today.
With the extras
by you for your sex.
And share it with your class.
Yeah,
when share
the information.
It's a USB, so you can plug it into numerous computers. You can email, probably pretty big to email. But there's a lot of good information on there. I personally print the install guides, and I've done hundreds, if not thousands, of installs. But I follow the guide every single time I'm in front of a game. I follow the paperwork because we're only dealing with three cabinets, three manufacturers. You guys are dealing with five or six or seven. So you make a confused effort on it, and then it's a ram clear to start all over. So floor's yours, Dan.
Thanks. Good afternoon, everyone. I know a couple of people out there, but I am Dan Lacerna. I run the communications for Scientific Games. I have currently 4 technicians, and it will be going up to 7 techs here within the next month. I know a lot of you have been experiencing a lot of delays in service. I've just been really shorthanded, people leaving, and I'm trying to get properly staffed. So hopefully within the next month, you will see our service calls, the response time is a lot better than what it is right now. I know a lot of you have been going out there assisting us in repairing some of the sites, but I do want to go over a couple things. I know you guys work with operations. Operations, they kind of give you incorrect information on when to reboot equipment and stuff like that, so I'm going to go over that with you guys today. So first thing I'll go over is the modem. I know a lot of you have been having some issues with modems out there. This is our first generation that we've used, the WR21. I know a lot of you look at the signal strength through the bars. I say don't really look at that. I mean, there's false information sometimes. If a site has very, very poor signal and there's no connection, sometimes it'll show 3 bars. You would see it as 3 bars, but really it's not. You guys don't have that ability to log into it, but operations can. So they know what the IP address of the modem, they'll be able to log into the IP address of the modem through the TC, they'll be able to log in and see what that the signal strength and the noise ratio is. But you know, on this one, you can look at just the power service. The real one is making sure that the service light is actually on. If the service light doesn't have any light, then most likely the modem is bad. Even if it during a reboot and you still have no service light, this is most likely bad. The next one is the WR11. This is the newer style. This is 4G capable. Currently the only carrier that's running 4G on it is Verizon, and AT&T we would have to do some back-end stuff, but it will go to 4G. This one here only has 3 lights. A lot of you don't know what the lights mean. The one thing you want to look at is the service light. If the service light is blinking either 5 times or 6 times, it is at its optimal performance for the modem. All lights should be green, so you'll see the power light green, the signal green, and then the service light blinking either 5 or 6 times in green. If you see an amber light, it usually tells you that it is a poor signal. Or poor to fair to poor, and then if it's completely off for either the service or signal, that means it's very bad, there's no signal at all. Next here, this is the TC. A lot of you have been swapping these out for G2S swaps for us. Some have been servicing it. I know with operations, they do tell you at times to reboot the equipment. That way they can see the equipment on our back end. If they tell you to reboot the equipment at the TC level, if your site is operational, personally, I would say not to reboot the TC. The issue then, if they can't see it on their end, but your site is online, is there's something wrong with the modem. So if you turn your TC off, even though operations says to turn it off, it could bring your site down. And then that's when one of my guys would have to come out and service it. So if your site is operational and we just can't see it on our back end, question them and make sure, because then your site could go down. If your site is offline and you do have to turn it off, we strongly suggest not to do a hard power down, either by switch on the back, unplugging it, or holding the circular black button until it turns off. What you need to do is just press the black button in the front and then wait about 30 seconds to 45 seconds for it to do its complete shutdown. It's almost like a laptop where you go and you hit shutdown on your laptop and it closes all the processes. What happens is when you do power cycle it, it's like a power outage. You can add corruption into the TC causing the site not to work. Yes?
Just this week, they specifically told me to do the hard power down.
Yeah, I would need to know who would.
They literally described the back of the machine, flipped the switch on the back is what I wanted you to do, which of course I already knew was there, but I'm letting you know.
Did they try and have you tap the button first?
No.
Yeah, so it's just it's not a press and hold for 30 or 40 seconds, just touch and release.
They didn't even do the press and hold. He specifically said close the back of the machine by the power supply and flip the switch.
So we are working on a flow chart with operations on how to troubleshoot. A lot of them are, some people are there and they just tell everyone to shut stuff down and stuff like that. But if you know someone, we call the name, I'll give you my contact because we do have to work with them because was your site operational when you got there?
I didn't even have a time to check. That was the phone call I got to go there. But when I got there, I called them. They said, this is what I want you to do. Flip the switch on the back of the PC.
Yeah, we don't really want to do that. It'll add corruption. One thing you could also, if you guys ever go out there, if you ever hear the TC, the black one, and it's the fans are really high, most likely your TC is corrupted. I just had one today where I got there. I noticed that there's no activity on the hard drive, the yellow amber light, and then I pressed the button. It never shut down. I had to do a hard power down because even tapping it, and a minute later, it still didn't. But when I turned it back on, the fan cuts on real high, and then it should drop down, but it didn't. So that right there tells me that the TC is corrupted. So the next one is the new style. I don't know if everyone has seen them, but this is the new style TC. This one's a little bit easier. There's only one power switch. It's a rocker switch. All you have to do is just press it, and about 10 to 15 seconds, it actually shuts down. So this one's a lot quicker than the older black box. Has everyone worked with the new one? So this one actually has two Cat 5s, and then there's actually two COM ports. If you're doing a TC swap and you've never dealt with this silver box, just make sure that it's plugged into the LAN too, which is closest to the power, which is this green little power adapter. Just make sure it's on the LAN too, so closest to that power. When you're actually looking at it, the LAN 1 and LAN 2 kind of looks like it could be either or, but it's the one closest to the power. Let's see. Anyone have any questions?
Bruce? Since you're short staffed right now, would you be interested in letting us swap the PCs ourselves? We have our G2S. People who are already doing the G2S site controllers, if there's a level of trust, would you be willing to maybe let them have a spare and maybe ease up some of your workload and help us out?
We've already given, Brittany. We've given Brittany, you guys do have spare, Brianna.
Yeah.
Brianna does have at least one or two spare we've given of the TC that's factory. So
It's so if it's, yeah, if the site is down because of a TC, if you guys want to grab that one, we could actually use it.
Okay with that?
Yeah, just give us a heads up and then either myself, Bill, or Sabash.
Yeah.
And we'll go out, you know. We'll see the service call.
Yeah.
And then if you say, hey, we have a TC, and then you guys can go out and look at the TC.
All right.
So it's this one right here is the land two. So how you can see the land two and land one. Most people do plug it in over here. We do see connection, but then it won't actually go live because it's actually on the wrong port. So
is that able to be activated? So if somebody blow land two, can we call and say, hey, can you change your port setting?
That I don't know. I would have to talk to the developers on what needs to be done to the TC. That's a good question. I'll ask that.
It's a tricky question because it runs on Ubuntu Linux. And it has to be written in there.
Yeah. Bill Zimmerman was supposed to be here today, but he couldn't make it, so. Guys do know that site will stay up without communication for up to 72 hours. So just make sure,
yeah. So that's why if you reset the TC, you bring the whole site down. Correct. The site controller is just that, it's controlling the whole site. If you reset that site controller during a lapse of communication, everything's gonna stay down.
You have one EGM out there and it does not have cons and you're working on it, and somebody tells you to turn the site controller, that's why Dan said don't do that. It's one of the reasons. Only work on that machine and the wires going to the net gear. If you down the net gear, you down the modem, you down the site controller, you're probably gonna down the entire location. Yeah, well that's true. So if you have a power failure and you don't have comms, and everything comes back up and you still don't have comms, all your machines are going to be disabled. Even if you don't have comms, you lose your modem. All the other machines will stay up for 72 hours. It does not need a modem to work for 72 hours.
Does that apply when you ask Cygain to do the cycle? Obviously, you've got top communications.
Yeah, if you have communications, that's a whole other story.
If we can see it, if my operations team can see the site, yeah, we could reboot everything there.
They're resetting the stack. They're not doing a power reboot to the TC. They're more or less resetting the stack.
Correct. So they're resetting all the programs inside the TC.
Go ahead.
The situation you just described is exactly what happened to us this morning. The technician went out there, one machine, they couldn't see it. And the recommendation was to be a boot controller. Took it down, the whole site's down right now.
Was the site, so the site was not working at first, correct?
It was reporting no revenue yesterday, so
one machine.
It was already an issue. We did some looking into it, but had zero revenue yesterday, according to the morning report. But she didn't know that at the time. She was just talking, trying to get one machine up, and I don't know. I think it was. I want to say it was Al. Maybe suggested her reboot the site controller, and then came back up, and now they're all down. So the recommendation would be if the machine, the cable's good, and everything else seems fine, what would your next recommendation be? Just press that button for 2 seconds on the.
No, you just tap that button.
Yeah, you
tap. Don't hold it for a couple seconds. You do a long press on it.
I think that I would see, okay, so I'm going to reply back to the operations center. Do you see the site? Do you have access to the modem? What condition is the modem?
You, like Dan,
diluted.
And that's what we're working on. We're working on a whole troubleshooting flow chart. You know, there's multiple places where operations can see a site. They are right now, they are looking at just one thing, and they're not looking at everything that's available to them. So they're really concentrated on one, and then they say, I don't see it, I want you to reboot it. Well, that's...
Yeah, so you got to make sure you have comms first. If you don't have a comms, I'm not going to shut down all my games. I'm just not going to do it until I have comms.
If you only have one game down, don't shut down that TC. It's... Now, if all games are down, RT is down, everything is down, even if it's on G2S or MCD, well, if it's on an MCD, you probably have an MCD issue. But if it's G2S and all the games are down and they can't see the site, most likely it is probably something wrong with the actual TC. But if only one game's down, I would really not reboot that TC. All right, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I just like Becky, I believe she helped me out. All efforts in the G2S already came up because of the G2S issue, but she did exhaust all efforts when I called somebody else, kind of left the whole other story. But she did exhaust all efforts.
Mm, did she got it up? Did she get the site?
No, it wasn't up. It was just a G2S effort. Revo, certification, everything. And she could actually see it. It kept on staying in the paper status. Come up, go back down. Come up, go back down.
Yeah, and sometimes that can be a connection issue.
Yeah, but you can exhaust all efforts and remove the whole site.
Did you guys try different ports in the Netgear?
No, it's probably okay. If we see that, it's either the TC could be corrupted and the back end, it might not have enough time for them to log in to see.
Sure.
Or it just be a connection issue. I know a lot of TOs are doing the TC swaps for us, and when they move it from the back of the game, they move it up on the top of top of the shelf, you can actually have worse signal now on top of the shelf. And that could possibly be what the issue is a poor connection. How long ago was this?
This was maybe 3 weeks ago.
About 3 weeks ago? The site's up now, though?
Yeah, it's up there.
What was it at?
It was Tim Park South.
And you're with?
Gold Rush.
Gold Rush? I think I had a service call out there. I might have, but we do go out and we do repair the signal at these locations. So we're trying to get the best signal out there, especially with G2S, since we need the fastest, best signal for G2S.
Newer people when I call, you have newer people that actually, they're really hyped about helping, they're really trying to get that effort going, and I just want to make sure that they can see that information correctly.
I'll make sure they know. Thanks.
Dan, the newer style modems, how susceptible are they to movement and corrupting the signal? Because for a little while, I was being told that if they moved at all, it would enable some security protocol and it wouldn't transmit out at all.
I'm
just asking if that's an issue or not.
No, it isn't. The black one, if it's a Verizon modem, it's a lot better. Moving it from one to another, it's not as bad. It is 4G, so it does penetrate better through the walls. It's not like the 3G ones that we have.
Well, he was specifically saying if I moved it at all, like to plug and unplug the modem, it's like, did you move it at all? Because it would activate the security protocols and it would shut down the modem.
Talk to Al, didn't you?
we're not going to say any names.
Sounds like Al.
I'm like, oh yeah, yeah. I'm worried about that. It's called picking
out. No, it doesn't. It doesn't do anything. You can disconnect. If operations tells you to disconnect the modem, to reestablish, that's fine. But yeah, I don't know.
This there's only one in and out port on the one reception port on the new modems, right?
Yeah, there's only one power. There's only two connections: the power and then the Cat 5.
And then the Cat 5.
Yeah. Okay. It's the same as the old. Well, the older ones have a serial port on it, but we don't use that.
Okay.
So they are antennas, and
antennas work in the best form standing up. I've been to so many locations where I've literally found the modem laying on the floor. You know, they put Velcro on them and the gauge heat up 2 years later and they fall down. Or people bend the antennas, they're old CDers and they think that by changing, you're going to get better.
We don't want them up. We don't want the antennas like this. If it's sitting on top of a TC or on a shelf, we don't want it this way. We want it straight up, just like that. If it's against the wall, like this, not sideways and not down. Even if you have a magnetic antenna at your location and someone slaps it on the side of the game and it's sideways, it's supposed to be straight up.
Or on top of a steel roof.
Yes.
Numerous times where they put the antenna out, they extend it as far as possible towards the front of the house and the light. The front of the house is always the place to go. But then they stick it on a steel roof, pointing down. It doesn't work like that. Up is up and down is down.
So yeah, and especially on these two, straight up. I don't know how many times I've been out to locations. I know it's most likely my team, well, my former team, but some of them are not around anymore. And I do see modems just like this, and this is not the right way. Should be straight up like that. We are trying to get away from the Velcro. I hate the Velcro because, you know, it's behind the game and we go out there, it's poor signal. If you see a site that's not reporting, all of a sudden it stops reporting, go ahead and head out there before my guys get out there. And I bet you any money that modem is probably on the floor. I know I had one yesterday out in Hoffman Estates. That's all it was. Unfortunately, the site didn't have a shelf, so I had to put new Velcro on it and then inform the TO. Once they go G2S, put that shelf and then I put that motor on top of that shelf. You guys have any other questions? Any side games questions that I could try to answer?
Yeah.
Why is it when you call in and they go, oh, we can't see the machine, you go, okay, can you put Steve on the phone, Steve gets on, oh, there it is. Why, and someone says he runs different software, why doesn't everybody have the super software so they can see it right away?
That's not true, they all have the same software. That's the whole training part that we're doing with the flow chart or everything, that way they know where to look. It's really in depth of what we're doing. It's taking a lot of time, but we're hoping to have it rolling out before the end of the year. So that way, when you call in, I got four of the five games down. That way, they can say, okay, they have partial games. Go here. Can you see it in this program? Yes or no. Can you see it in this program? Yes or no. That's how the flow chart's going to be. You know, use this program, use that program to help troubleshoot it with you guys out of the field.
There's a lot of new things going on right now with the Illinois VLT market, switching over from SAS to G2S. Everybody's learning. We're learning, you guys are learning, and really so is Scientific Games. They've got a whole new staff coming in, people have left like Dan alluded to, so we're all in this together. If we work together, it'll be much quicker. Dan came on board, and he's done a bang-up job, in my opinion, getting new people, getting them up to speed, so I think, you know, if you give some of these new folks a little bit of time, and Al, you said Al too, they never have that flowchart, and now they're building out that flowchart. So.
Yeah, especially with G2S, I mean, it's a totally different beast of what we were used to in the past. So it's going to help everyone out.
And they're still working with SAS.
Yep.
You got to remember that. There's a team of five or six people answering phone calls from all over the state, dealing with SAS, dealing with G2S, dealing with multiple manufacturers, and multiple problems. Yes, sir.
Yes, another question. G2S comp, constantly evolving, these GPS evolving, would there be more content added to GPS? If, I mean, like far as more functions, far as the games. Like, is it a global sense?
Actually, we're going to address that during, when we go over G2S later in the day. We're going to have G2S set up and troubleshooting and some of the perks of G2S. We're going to go over that after lunch. No, but they're working on that. The attendant printouts are being requested even from the IGB. So it's well been documented that everyone wants it, and they're working on trying to see if they can write it into a patch, and then later when they send an update down the line, if it's approved through the normal channels, GLI, IGB, Tinneroff testing, they would push it out. And then all of a sudden you guys can print out attendant menu printouts and stuff. And they're also working on hand pay vouchers for G2S, which are non-existent right now, but they're working towards, and there's still no promises yet, for getting that implemented into the G2S environment. So when you go turn the attendant key, it kicks out a receipt or a voucher for that hand pay. And again, we'll go more into depth about this later in the day when we're talking about G2S, because there's a lot of known issues that we're gonna cover.
Is there a reason why they stopped printing on?
No, I'm not sure why they didn't write it into the code. We asked a bit.
It wasn't a must. So IGB says you must do this.
Oh.
It wasn't in that must. Yeah. So it was eliminated by a programmer for whatever reason. So it's coming back.
If they would have wrote the rules today, it would have been a requirement. Right. And they would have written it around those requirements. So the only other thing Bill went over was new software is coming down the pike. And
new OS software.
New operating systems for
fixing
everything.
Fixing a lot of voucher issues.
So there'll be a new Valley OS approved that'll accomplish a couple of things besides voucher issues. It's going to accommodate a new Valley CPU and the BIOS therein, because there'll be a 2.4 computer now for the Valley. As soon as they get it all approved, that new operating system will support the new computer and new BIOS chip that you'll have to have. So instead of now having to remember two BIOS chips, you'll have to remember three BIOS chips for the Valley. There's two new operating systems coming for WMS, one for the Bluebird. Right now, the current operating system is 16 Henry Foxtrot. The newest one will be 16 Henry Foxtrot Charlie. And then the Blades, they have right now NSOS 000-4071. The newer one will be 4071C, Charlie. And then both will be valid, because eventually the ones that are just regular 4071 or 16 Henry Foxtrot, they'll push the newer operating system onto your machines that are already G2S. So it's just going forward, you might start receiving G2S kits. And we'll go over this later when we're talking about G2S. You'll receive kits that have these newer items in them.
One thing I know Bill did talk about is the TC swaps that a lot of the TOs are doing. If you are out there doing a TC swap and making the site G2S from the older SAS version TC, make sure that the connection is good before you start and before you move that modem up onto that shelf. If you can try to put the TC where it is now, have operations do their thing in pulling the voucher database, putting the voucher database back onto the new one, and then if they see everything, then move that up into the new shelf or wherever you're putting the equipment. Because sometimes a lot of people are actually moving everything, and then when they put it up there, it doesn't work anymore because the connection is actually bad. Or they can't continue on with the connection. Yeah, it is poor and they can't connect fast enough. If we get that, if it's working somewhere else, and then we bring it up there, if we have somewhat of a good connection, it will continue on and bring the site up. But it's kind of harder to pull the voucher database when the connection. machines we have. Oh, another thing with the modems, if you are relocating the modems, if you guys are using cabinets, like server racks or little short, small little server racks, don't put that modem inside that server rack. Somehow mount it on top or somewhere where it's not inside, because it's a metal box. It's like putting your cell phone inside a metal box, you're not gonna get signal. So make sure that that modem stays on the outside somewhere of that box. Some locations, I know they put it right against the ceiling tile. What I've been doing at locations like that is I've just been putting the modem up on top of the ceiling tile, and instead of putting it inside that box.
A lot of the cafes run it that way, where they run the equipment in the back room right there.
Correct.
Up high.
Yeah, they put it up high, or yeah, if I put it, I try to put it, try to find somewhere where I can put it rather than inside that shelf.
At G2S also, when you're flipping over to G2S, we have multiple cabinets printing same voucher number. On a Valley, you need to build test that machine at least three times.
They lower the batch amount from 20, so you don't have to push 21 vouchers out to purge it. The purge now only be three, if you see that. There's a lot less of these going on.
Yeah, there was a patch that was sent out when it was recognized we were having duplicate, there was duplicate ticket numbers on, but not just Valley, it was WMS.
And if that happens to a WMS, Rancler, your only salvation is just Rancler the WMS and start over. They, like Dan alluded to, they had sent out patches. Whether that patch is made into every single cabinet, I don't personally know, but if you have that problem, usually on a WMS, you just Rancler it, it'll resend those batch. Those tickets to that EGM, you know, issue solve the problem.
It's going to send it actually to the TC.
Yeah.
It really doesn't, yeah, it's the game that requests the voucher number from the TC. So
yeah.
It's what we sent over to the TC, is what we sent over. That's it. Anybody else have any questions? I'll be here for a little bit, so if you want to pull me during a break, during the first break, I'll be sitting right over there, so I stay for the next two breaks. So.
We're going to go ahead and take a break now for about 10 or 15 minutes, and when we come back, we're going to go into Valley. So go ahead and use the bathroom, get some coffee, soda, water, whatever you want. All right? Thanks, guys.
I usually jump around.
every machine should have.
That cheat sheet, so you know, you can check mark off all of them.
So, for example, you might as well just attack my own, the car, and just call, but if it's easy, some of the guys are out of the office, so she'll tell me call. So, what's going to happen in front of the office? We already have it. The guys are looking for those guys, but then Reginald's going to have to take it, get a service ticket.
Equipment.
and then the operators are responsible for flipping their machines over. Now, some of the really small operators that don't do very much at all, they usually will request us to come out and operate our machines for them, because it's not cheap, but it's like they have a budget for it. Once people see that, in my mind, there was problems with Suite 4 SAS and Suite 5 SAS already. That would cause people nightmares, red boxes, tons of service calls out to remote locations 2 hours away just to turn the attention key. So the benefits, even though there's a few little hiccups here and there, outweigh nightmares that were proceeding. So, and then again, so with the ability to do upgrades and updates and patches, G2S, as they see problems, they can address them, submit them, and they get them fixed without having to ever get an agent who set keys out there.
Self-correct.
So we're going to get started here in about 5 minutes and pass around some equipment for balance and everyone has some hands on it. No problem. Were you the last one to walk in? Did you say it? Did you get a pen? There's a lot of the latter half of the day will be about G2S conversion. And then there's also some cabinet material. There's all the different G2S guides.
They're all three of like manufactured multiple pages.
There's and the error codes. Like if you get a crazy open door D, a lot of different doors. B, there's a breakdown of all the valley that's a common question. People say they have a D door or a U door or a T door problem, and we're going to go over their simple fixes. But to explain this to somebody over the phone is not where we get from operations. No, we broke in a couple of days ago. Before science got cold. That's a document. But that's for the entire company. We're going to have a specific, probably a Dropbox that everyone will be able to access that will have kind of like a psychic portal. We'll eventually have a site on board for our documentation. And then you'll also be able to pull videos so that you can watch the video and step by step. Guys, we got 5 more minutes. I'll give you before we start. And I'm gonna lay a microphone in front of each set of tables because some of you guys still are talking kind of faintly, and I want the other people in the room to hear your questions so they know what's being answered. So I'm gonna leave a microphone over here. I'll leave a microphone over there. If somebody's talking, I'll give them the hand on the mic so they can be heard. You won't have a problem hearing me. I've been told to tone it down.
Inside voice, man. Inside
voice. You're going to hear me. Humble.
What was that, Bob?
I have a drinking problem. I can't. Huh? Yes, right?
Thank you.
Side games cabinet, and we'll explain a lot of it about that one on the end is the side games twin star cabinet. We'll go over that. Then we'll have lunch, and after lunch, we save the best for last. We'll go over the G2S setup, problems, issues, all kinds of stuff. And you know, we allocated a lot of time for that because it's obviously a big issue. At the end of every hour, we'll have Q&A about each section. So near the end, we'll ask questions about the valley. And before I even get started, I'm going to start passing out some back plane boards. A lot of you might recognize this is the back plane board for the 22 and the 32. This is the back plane board for the Wave and the 27. I'm going to pass these around for a couple of reasons. One, so you can get familiar. A lot of people have never seen the way backplane boards. It's kind of hidden underneath the computer. And then I'm sending three backplane boards out for the 22. One to show you how the battery is mounted properly and how a good-looking board should look. The other two don't have a battery in it for the very reason that there's one that says bad. Because somebody tried to shove a battery in there straight in, and they crushed the terminals. And then guess what? You're going to have a door monitor battery fail every time. Ram clear it again. I still have a door monitor battery fail. So, and then this one is actually shows the tabs still intact, and then you can kind of see the tabs on the battery that's installed. It also gives you a feel for where the connectors are. RCA cable right in the middle is your audio that runs up to the amp. A lot of people say, I don't have audio. Well, they threw the Milog in there and it yanks that cable right out of the backplane board. So we're going to pass out these backplane boards, just pass them along, and they'll work their way around the room and then back to me. And then we're also going to pass out the with Valley CPUs. Now, this one, well, yeah, let's start with this one. Very easy to tell, even from your distance out there, what computer this is. What's that?
Well, it's right down there, but yeah, it's 2.0.
What?
2.0.
Yeah, but there's bright ports right there, bright red or pink, green, and blue audio ports. You will only see these audio ports on a 2.0 CPU. You won't see them on the 2.1, and you won't see them on the soon-to-come 2.4. Another way you can determine if it's a 2.0 is the number on it will be like a 219 number. Right next to the software door, there's a sticker that indicates which CPU it is. You see a 219737, it's a 2.0. I'm going to pass these around so you guys can see the BIOS socket, the JIR socket, video cards. There's two different video cards here too. The older 2.0 has the older K600 video card. And then the newer 2.1 has the newer K620. And then I still haven't even had one in my hands yet, but the new 2.4 has a newer, better video card in it to boot.